against these types of injustices. Therefore, we must consider stronger measures than we have before, including the possibility of suspending aid to a government that has taken the lives and the livelihoods of an entire ethnicity within its borders. American tax dollars should not fund any kind of foreign assistance going to regimes responsible for disenfranchising over a million of its own people, much less conducting a coordinated campaign of ethnic cleansing. The arrival of this pandemic has only worsened the condition facing the Rohingya, as many find themselves in either overcrowded refugee camps with little access to medical attention and equipment. As we move toward developing a reliable vaccine for COVID-19, international vaccine organizations like Gavi and CEPI must play an active role in helping deliver life-saving medical treatment to the Rohingya, many of whom find themselves without a government willing to provide for their well-being. I look forward to the hearing from our witnesses and my fellow colleagues on how we can change these goals. And thank you. And I apologize, I'm on a cell phone and I can't read my notes. Thank you.
Thank you, Ranking Member Yoho. In a moment, I'm going to introduce our witnesses and recognize them for their statements. But I'd like to take 1 minute to yield a minute to my good friend, Mr. Chabot, who's been a leader on speaking out on behalf of the Rohingya and introduced with Chairman Engel the Burma Act, which the committee and the House passed last year. Mr. Chabot.
Thank you very much, Chairman Barra, and also Ranking Member Yoho, and I'll be brief. We all know the tragic story about what happened here, how beginning in August of 2017, the Burmese military carried out a systematic, premeditated campaign of murder, rape, and terror, amounting to genocide against the Rohingya. Since then, I've worked with my colleagues on both sides of the aisle, and I want to especially thank Elliot Engel and also Joe Crowley, who was instrumental in working on this during his time in Congress, trying to raise awareness in our country and around the globe on this issue and hold the perpetrators accountable. The House overwhelmingly voted in favor of proclaiming these atrocities a genocide and in sanctioning the perpetrators. Yet despite the outrage, not much has really changed over the last 3 years. The humanitarian situation remains frozen with a million Rohingya in refugee camps in Bangladesh, while international pressure has had little impact on the behavior of the Burmese government or on the Burmese military. With this in mind, we must not let the passage of time nor fatigue numb our horror at what happened in 2017 and what's happening to this day, nor our resolve to achieve a solution. So thank you for holding this, and I yield back.
Thank you, Mr. Chabot. I'll now introduce our witnesses. Our witnesses for today's hearing are the Honorable Eric Schwartz, Ms. Weiwei Niu, Ms. Allison Neville, and Ms. Olivia Enos. I'd like to thank all our witnesses for being here today. The Honorable Eric Schwartz is currently President of Refugees International. He previously served as U.S. Assistant Secretary of State for Population, Refugees, and Migration from 2009 to 2011. Ms. Weiwei Niu is the founder and executive director of the Women's Peace Network in Myanmar. Niu is currently serving as a fellow at the Simon Scott Center for the Prevention of Genocide, U.S. Holocaust Memorial Museum. She spent 7 years as a political prisoner in Burma. Allison Neville is Associate Director for International Humanitarian Response Policy and Advocacy at Save the Children, where she focuses on education in emergencies and the protection of children in conflict, as well as the Rohingya response in Afghanistan. And finally, Ms. Olivia Enos is a Senior Policy Analyst in the Asian Studies Center at the Heritage Foundation, where she focuses on human rights and national security challenges in Asia, including democracy and governance challenges, refugee issues, and other challenges. I will now recognize each witness for 5 minutes, and without objection, your prepared written statements will be made part of the record. I will first call on the Honorable Eric Schwartz for your testimony. Mr. Schwartz.
Thank you, Chairman Vera and members of the subcommittee for holding this hearing and for your important efforts surrounding the Rohingya. I will summarize my written remarks submitted for the record. August 25th will mark 3 years since the start of the expulsion of more than 700,000 Rohingya from Myanmar, also known as Burma. Nearly 900,000 are in camps in Bangladesh. Hundreds have recently been stranded at sea after being turned back from Malaysia and Bangladesh, and many have certainly drowned. Some 600,000 Rohingya remain in Burma, facing ongoing abuses. I'm going to address challenges in the refugee camps in Bangladesh, ongoing abuses in Burma, and the question of genocide, and the global humanitarian imperatives around COVID-19. I'll begin with the challenges in Bangladesh. While small numbers of Rohingya in the camps have tested positive for COVID-19, testing is limited, and the worst is yet to come. Access restrictions and other indirect effects of the pandemic have worsened conditions, and we're very worried about COVID-19's negative impact on gender-based violence in particular. Misinformation about COVID-19 is pervasive in the camps and compounded by Bangladesh government restrictions on communication. And we remained alarmed by government plans and early efforts to move Rohingya to Basanchar, an island in the Bay of Bengal, in light of serious questions about safety and voluntariness of such movements. In Rakhine State in Burma, conditions remain unacceptable. And it bears mention that abuses in Burma are not restricted to the Rohingya, but extend to several ethnic minority groups throughout the country. I'll now turn to the question of genocide and the request of a broad coalition that the State Department declare Burma responsible for genocide. This request, of course, is consistent with the December 2018 House resolution that also called attacks on the Rohingya genocide. As reflected in the Refugees International Statement on Genocide, the state of Burma is indeed responsible for killing thousands of Rohingya, among other abuses specified in the Genocide Convention, with the intent to destroy, in whole or in part, this population. I ask that the Refugees International Statement on Genocide be included in the hearing record. A declaration would recognize the crime for what it is and promote accountability. It would bring global attention that could help prevent further atrocities. It could rally international pressure. It would signal solidarity with both the Rohingya and with Bangladesh and other countries that are hosting Rohingya. Finally, I would be remiss if I did not return to the broader global response to COVID-19. Especially as it implicates the Rohingya. In a webinar in which the chairman participated, the UN's Emergency Relief Coordinator, Mark Lowcock, recently said that COVID-19 could conceivably infect over 600 million people in the world's most vulnerable countries. Mark estimated that the cost of protecting the most vulnerable 10% of the world's population from the worst effects of COVID-19 was about $90 billion. He added that this would represent less than 1% of the amount devoted to COVID-19 stimulus packages by wealthy countries of the world. A $90 billion figure is reasonable. In fact, it may be low. And we and others are urging a $20 billion US contribution, reflecting both a moral imperative and the simple fact that this virus knows no borders. Let me also emphasize the importance of broad access to affordable treatments, access to a vaccine, and our concern that governments are pursuing what the UN Secretary General has expressed concern about, vaccine nationalism. To conclude, I urge members to press the administration to continue US leadership in the humanitarian response in Bangladesh, to request administration progress reports on funding and on critical implementation issues involving the government of Bangladesh that are highlighted in my written testimony. I urge that you press the administration to issue a finding of genocide. And finally, on the COVID-19 response globally, which impacts the Rohingya so dramatically. I hope you will press for supplemental assistance of $20 billion, as well as for equitable access to treatment and to vaccines. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Schwartz. I will now call on Ms. Wei-Wei Niu for her testimony.
Thank you, Chairman Vera, Ranking Member Yoho, and members of the subcommittee for the opportunity to update you today. I want to thank the U.S. House of Representatives for demonstrating a strong commitment to end mass atrocities in Myanmar. Distinguished members, I was just 18 years old when Myanmar military regime put me and my family in prison in 2005. My father was a political leader allied with the Aung San Suu Kyi during the democracy movement. But unlike other politicians, my father was targeted because he is Rohingya. My entire adult life has been dedicated to fighting this persecution. I knew from an early age that we were targeted because of our ethnicity and religion. Imagine our excitement and hope when we were able to join our country in the beginning of democratic transition in 2012 after 7 years of imprisonment. But our hope were quickly shattered when Myanmar military ravaged the Rakhine state that same year, burning villages to the ground and displacing tens of thousands of my people, many of whom still live in destitute camps today. In August 2017, the military unleashed a campaign of clearance operations, which resulted in mass destructions, killing, and expulsions of over 850,000 people to flee across the border to Bangladesh. The UN fact-finding missions on Myanmar and the Holocaust Memorial Museum determined this violence purged to be a genocide. Violence, sexual violence, primarily against women and girls, and but also men and boys, was used as a weapon and left a trail of trauma, and that will last generations. Now, 3 years on, over 1 million Rohingya people living in limbo in squalid refugee camps in Bangladesh, as you described, barely surviving with a few donations items from NGOs. In countries like Malaysia, Thailand, India, Rohingya are targeted for hate speech and many live in fear. And it is still remain too unsafe for the Rohingya to return to Myanmar, where over 600,000 Rohingya remaining in the country face systemic persecutions and living under the threat of genocide. Dear distinguished members, all of this was preventable. This was the failure to address root causes of persecutions against Rohingya. Similar tactics used against ethnic minorities in Myanmar for decades continue today as military inflict abuses on civilians in Rakhine, Shan, and Karen state while the peace process has been stalled. So far, impunity has reigned for mass atrocities in Myanmar. Despite of the dire situations of the Rohingya, I have been deeply inspired by the sheer resilience and the unwavering spirit of my people. Your leadership and interest in Myanmar is critical to our success. Here are 7 key demands from the Rohingya community in Myanmar, Bangladesh, and the diaspora on how you can support us. First, my people want to return to our homeland with the restorations of full citizenship rights and equal rights and restitutions of the damage to our land and livelihood. We cannot be relocated to the internment camps or segregated Muslim zone to be forced to identify ourselves as Bengali via national verification card. Second, I want to thank the US for imposing sanctions on Myanmar military officials and ask that you also impose financial sanctions on military-owned businesses since the income generated from these businesses enable the military to continue its brutal act. Third, the US Congress must pass the Burma Act. Fourth, the US must support international criminal accountability efforts, as it is clear that Myanmar lacks both the political will and independent judiciary to deliver justice. Fifth, the Rohingya people still being denied the right to vote despite of our long history of political participation and leadership in Myanmar. The US Congress must strongly urge the Myanmar government to hold free, fair, and fully inclusive elections on November 2020. Without the participation of Rohingyas, these elections cannot pass as a democratic act. Sixth, the US government should call the crimes what they are, genocide. Refusing to do so help the Myanmar government in its aim to deny our identity and existence as Rohingya people. Finally, it is imperative that every government and agencies consult the Rohingya people in all decisions impact our life. I appreciate you inviting me here today, and you must push Myanmar government to work with Rohingya people to address root causes and bring about a long-term solution. I would like to thank Chair Bera, Ranking Member Yoho, and members of the subcommittee one more time for giving me this opportunity to brief you all, and I look forward to your questions. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. New, for your testimony. I will now call on Ms. Allison Neville for her testimony.
Chairman Bera, Ranking Member Yoho, and distinguished members of the subcommittee, thank you for the opportunity to testify on the Rohingya crisis. Since our founding more than 100 years ago, Save the Children's work has changed the lives of more than 1 billion children in the United States and around the world. Specific to the Rohingya crisis, we support the needs of children and their families in the refugee camps and host community in Bangladesh, as well as in the camps for displaced communities in the central part of Myanmar's Rakhine State. I will be summarizing my written testimony, which speaks in more detail to the humanitarian needs and challenges across these contexts. First, I want to express appreciation for the work of this subcommittee and all those in Congress and the executive branch who have remained committed to addressing the needs and rights of the Rohingya. Even as this month marks the solemn three-year anniversary of the atrocities that occurred against the Rohingya and other Muslim minorities in Rakhine State, new challenges have emerged. These include the COVID-19 pandemic that is threatening lives in and around the camps in Bangladesh, the ongoing conflict in Myanmar's Rakhine and Chin states that continues to kill and displace civilians, and increasing stress factors that have led hundreds, including higher percentages of children, to take dangerous journeys by sea seeking refuge. I would like to take a few minutes to speak directly to the conditions for the tens of thousands of children and adolescents we serve in Bangladesh through our temporary learning centers and child-friendly programming. There have been laudable efforts to build up the refugee camps and provide services. However, when I was on the ground in December, one of the most notable things I heard was that the current situation, quote, could be the best things get. This already was an unacceptable scenario, and with the spread of COVID-19, the situation has predictably deteriorated. Our child protection staff was already concerned about increasing reports of child marriage, child labor, and trafficking. Many children still live with the effects of their exposure to rights violations in Myanmar. Psychological distress and negative coping mechanisms are increased by factors like the inability to access livelihood opportunities, limited access to education, and the lack of progress on the ground in Myanmar to allow for voluntary and safe returns. It is estimated that nearly 70% of Rohingya children in the camps require access to mental health support. Despite the educational services that we and others provide, when you walk around the camps, you'll see many children out of school. This occurs due to a variety of factors, including the need to accommodate multiple two-hour classroom shifts due to space constraints and limited availability of the approved learning curriculum. The loss of education is most profound for girls, whose attendance drops off significantly as they get older and increases the risks of child marriage and adolescent pregnancies. This was the reality before the pandemic required a shutdown of 80% of the services in the camps. Even as we work alongside other humanitarian actors to support the needs of refugees, there's a crucial opportunity for the United States and broader international community to ensure that the post-COVID-19 environment is not a return to the status quo or worse. The immense generosity and ongoing engagement of the U.S. government has been important and necessary. We urge the continuation of efforts to prioritize the immediate needs and long-term interests of the Rohingya. One, the U.S. government should take additional action to hold the perpetrators of violence against the Rohingya to account and encourage other countries to do so. This should include additional targeted sanctions on both individuals complicit in atrocities as well as military-owned companies. Two, the U.S. government should build on the diplomatic engagement with the governments of Myanmar and Bangladesh and other regional actors to support improved conditions on the ground and to ensure safety and protection for the Rohingya at sea. Three, the U.S. government should maintain its generosity in supporting humanitarian assistance on both sides of the border. Relatedly, Congress should fund and invest in the international COVID-19 response by providing no less than $20 billion in the next legislative package to address the pandemic. Life in a refugee or displaced person's camp should never be considered an acceptable long-term solution, especially for children. There are approximately 75,000 Rohingya who have been born as refugees since 2017, and an estimated 32,000 have been born in displacement settings in Rakhine State since 2012. An entire generation of Rohingya children risks growing up confined in camps. The Rohingya want to be able to return home safely, access their rights and freedoms, and live in peace. With your help, it is our hope that by this time next year, much will have been improved for the children who deserve a healthy start to life, access to education, and freedom from violence and harm. Every day matters. Thank you, and I look forward to answering your questions.
Thank you, Ms. Neville. And now I'll recognize Ms. Olivia Enos for her testimony.
Chairman Vera, Ranking Member Yoho, thank you for inviting me to testify before the subcommittee. Rajima, a young Rohingya woman, clutched her baby boy as she fled the Burmese military's brutal treatment of her Muslim community. It was then that her fragile world shattered. A soldier clubbed her on the head while others tore her baby from her arms and threw him into the fire. The violence did not stop with her child's death. The soldiers then proceeded to gang rape Rajima. Before the day was through, she had seen her mother and her three siblings killed. Rajima is far from the only Rohingya scarred by the Burmese military. Countless women and girls face sexual violence, including rape. At least 10,000 men, women, and children perished at the hands of the Burmese military during August 2017 clearing operations. And now at least 1 million Rohingya remain displaced in the world's largest refugee camp settlement in Cox's Bazar, Bangladesh. Salt is now being poured on the wounds of their suffering as Rohingya who endured these atrocities are now experiencing COVID-19. While thus far the rate of COVID-19 infections is seemingly quite low, 62 cases according to the United Nations Refugee Agency and only a handful of deaths, social distancing is a near impossibility, access to testing limited, and provision of medical care few and far between. Some have called it a potential tinderbox for an outbreak. The present is an opportune moment for Secretary Pompeo to declare with the United Nations, the U.S. Holocaust Memorial Museum, and PILPG, the group the State Department commissioned to do an atrocity report on the Rohingya, and many, many others have already said to be true, that Rohingya endured genocide and crimes against humanity. On August 25th, it will have been 3 years since the atrocities took place. The Secretary should consider issuing an atrocity determination to commemorate the anniversary and to bring justice to Rohingya. There are 5 reasons submitted to the record for why the U.S. government should issue an atrocity determination. I will cover 3 now. Number 1, a designation counters the narrative that the U.S. doesn't care about human rights. Atrocities committed against Rohingya are among the most significant human rights committed during the Trump presidency. A strong U.S. response would telegraph to other countries that the U.S. continues to support freedom and human rights. Failure to do so has the potential to embolden bad actors who will believe that there are little to no negative consequences for engaging in human rights violations while maintaining a diplomatic relationship with the U.S. Number two, a designation demonstrates U.S. commitment to preventing atrocities. Atrocity determinations transcend administrations and ensure that survivors receive the help they need, like in the case of the ISIS genocide determination during the Obama administration. While the Obama administration took limited follow-on action, the Trump administration did. Its Genocide Recovery and Persecution Response Program, which allocated nearly $350 million toward assisting victims of ISIS genocide, has tangibly alleviated suffering. Should the Trump administration issue a determination of its own on the Rohingya, it would demonstrate moral and political leadership and serve as an opportunity for the administration to highlight its burgeoning atrocity prevention efforts. Three, a designation is likely to increase burden sharing among countries. Credit should be given where credit is due. The U.S. is the top single country donor to Rohingya, giving just over $820 million since atrocities took place. Now, donor fatigue is setting in. This is compounded by the COVID-19 era, where countries' attentions are drawn inward as they battle their own COVID-19 crises. Current donations are not even scratching the surface of the immense needs. The United Nations 2020 Joint Response Plan requested an estimated $877 million for Rohingya just for this year, a year where the U.S. has so far only supplied an additional $59 million. The needs are great, and they cannot be met by a single, albeit highly generous, donor country. An atrocity determination now may serve as a catalyst for other countries to provide aid. I recommend that Congress and the executive branch pursue the following. First, make an official public legal determination on crimes committed against Rohingya. Second, evaluate relevant financial tools to craft an overarching sanctions policy toward Burma, one that targets Burmese military-owned enterprises like MEC and MEHL. Three, press the Bangladeshi government to lift restrictions on access to information inside of the camps. Four, grant priority to refugee status to Rohingya refugees. And five, reevaluate the need for aid both in the midst of the COVID-19 crisis as well as in the aftermath of the atrocities. An atrocity determination can be issued at any point in time. Secretary Pompeo has the authority and discretion to issue such a determination at whim. But should he choose not to, Congress also has the option to press the administration to do as it did in the case of ISIS genocide, which I'm happy to address more during Q&A. Perhaps this method could be successful again. Issuing a genocide determination now would be a win for the administration. The administration should do so now before it's too late. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Enos. I will now recognize members for 5 minutes each, and pursuant to House rules, all time yielded is for the purposes of questioning our witnesses. Because of the virtual format of this hearing, I will recognize members by committee seniority, alternating between Democrats and Republicans. If you miss your turn, please let our staff know and we will circle back to you. If you seek recognition, you must unmute your microphone and address the chair verbally. I will now start by recognizing myself. Ms. New, thank you for your advocacy on behalf of the Rohingya people and a truly democratic and inclusive Burma. I think it's an understatement, what started with much promise and admiration for Aung San Suu Kyi has led to disappointment in recent years. And I know this subcommittee, as well as the House, in a bipartisan way, has expressed that disappointment. What can you enlighten us as to what accounts for her failures? And is it that she just simply doesn't care about the Rohingya or consider them Burmese, and how we should approach this?
Thank you, Chairman Barra, for your questions and opportunity to address you once again. Yes, as you said, it is very disheartening to see her responses in this crisis before she become the head of the government and now under her administration. And the community, Rohingya community, and all other ethnic minorities in Myanmar expected that she is the one who brings the equality and justice for all other minorities. Instead, she turned away and side with the perpetrators, the military dictators, and stand with them in front of the International Court of Justice. And it is clear that her intention is not to protect its the country's minorities, but to protect the powers. And with that, even after the International Court of Justice provisionals, the orders, the provisionals measures orders, there is nothing has changed in the ground, the life of the people in the ground, and the policies that by the government itself, the state policies towards the Rohingya populations. Now she has the power to change the policies, for example, removing restrictions on the of the movement and allowing students to go to the universities. Now, since 2012, our students are not able to go to the university. In her administrations with her authority, she can change this, you know, minor changes. And her government's officials are continuing using the denying our identity as Rohingya and using referring us as Bengali. At the same time, her government is implementing a discriminatory citizenship process, which eventually led the Rohingya people to become non-citizens and lost all our rights, including our birthright to the land and right protections. I think some of these specific acts and policy that has not been addressed or continue imposing by her own administration can be pushed by your committee and U.S. government. So in terms of policy, changing policies, implementations, and practical changes in the grounds are essentials. And we want to see her taking leadership, return to the to make necessary arrangement for the return of the refugees and restore the full citizenship rights and equal rights of the Rohingya in Myanmar.
Thank you, Ms. In the short time I have remaining, obviously putting my doctor hat on and public health hat on, we are very worried that in Cox's Bazar, you know, if COVID-19 were to start spreading, that this would be, you know, a humanitarian disaster. I'm also very worried about the secondary and tertiary impact of this in terms of food insecurity, starvation, and the like. Maybe Mr. Schwartz or some of the other members, if you could just give us a sense of, you know, how challenging things are right now and some policies that, you know, I agree if we can get the $20 billion in this next supplemental, that would be a good first step. And I think that is incredibly important to help us support folks. But, you know, if any of the witnesses want to, you know, give us life on the ground in Cox's Bazar.
Well, thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'll be very brief and say that today, since we haven't seen the very worst of COVID-19 infections, to a great extent, the principal challenges that we're confronting, that humanitarians are confronting, are the indirect impacts of this pandemic. In Bangladesh, it has to do with, you know, a decrease in the number of humanitarians who are in the camps, restrictions on communications, difficulties with supply, and worldwide, that problem is arising in many different places. We did a report some weeks ago on the Sahel, and the focus of that report was not the direct impact of COVID-19, but rather significant food insecurity challenges based on restrictions in access, which just underscores the importance not only of a very generous COVID-19 supplemental globally, but also the need to continue to focus on not only the COVID-19 response, but the indirect impacts of COVID-19.
Right. Thank you, Mr. Schwartz. And I realize my time's out, so let me go ahead and recognize the ranking member, Mr. Yoho, 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and I appreciate all the witnesses' testimony. What is the key, and I think I'm going to ask this of Eric Schwartz, Ms. Schwartz, what is the key economic driver of the economy in Myanmar?
Well, I'm not an economist, but I will say that I think at this point, the most effective tools or, you know, pressure against the government of Burma would be to target military and military-owned enterprises.
All right. Well, let me ask you this, because that's not. I want to get, what is their biggest product or export product, and who is their largest trading partner? Is it China? And what is that product that brings in the most money for their economy?
Right.
Or anybody else?
Please. I would believe that China would almost certainly be their major trading partner. But in terms of the products, I think I would defer to others.
Allison, Ms. Neville, do you know?
I don't. I'm sorry. That's unfortunately not really something we can speak to, given our humanitarian priorities.
Well, let me just go with this, and because we see this over and over again. We see it in China, in the Xinjiang province. We see it elsewhere in the world, and we've said never again, but yet it happens over and over again. And without having a direct conflict, the best thing I think we can do as a nation is economic pressure. I would assume that China is their largest trading partner, but what other nations are coming to the table outside of the U.S.? What other developed nations? Are we seeing the EU? Are we seeing Japan? Are we seeing any other country? And then in particularly, since the majority of the Rohingya are Muslims and they practice their Muslim faith, or they try to, what Muslim countries are coming to the table to be actively engaged? Or is this the U.S. alone? Because if we can get these other countries engaged, we can put that economic pressure on there and squeeze them there in addition to the sanctions that we're doing. Does anybody want to comment on that?
Sure. I'd be happy to. I think, you know, key interlocutors, economic interlocutors for Burma include not only China, but India, Japan, Indonesia, the EU. And, you know, the challenge is to marshal an international effort. And there really has been an absence of leadership in that effort to marshal, a truly international effort. The Muslim world has governments with Muslim majority populations have been regularly supportive of declarations against what the Burmese military have done, but that hasn't really translated into genuine political and economic.
Okay, let me bring this up then. We know in January 2020, the UN reported a genocide going on and called their commander-in-chief and five generals should face charges of crimes. But yet the UN Security Council has yet to issue such a designation. This is just something I'm going to say, is that we as a nation need to invoke all these other nations, and we need to have this at the UN, to where they bring this up, and then from that, move that coalition to put that economic pressure on anybody that's trading with them. And again, what we see is China is the bad actor. China could come to the table and help us resolve so many issues around the world, yet they're on the opposite end, fuming and working against us. And until we get agreement and countries working in the same direction, this will not end. And Allison, Neville, you were saying, living in a refugee camp should never be normal. That should never be normal. But yet we've got refugee camps that have been going on for 20 plus 30 years because we can't get together as a world community and bring this stuff to an end. I don't really have any other comments, but I do know that if we don't work with some of these organizations like Gavi and the NGOs and get treatments and vaccinations for other diseases, the comorbidity are going to open up this population for the pandemic. And then we've got some challenges on our hand. And I hope America comes to the table and leads and brings other partners. Mr. Chairman, thank you for putting this meeting on. And I thank our witnesses, and I yield back.
Thank you to the ranking member. Let me now recognize the gentleman from California, Mr. Sherman. 5 minutes.
I think there should be a general recognition that we need to appropriate money in the next COVID bill to focus worldwide on the problem this is causing. And believe it or not, I'll commend the Republican Senate bill that has $4 billion in it to deal with the foreign policy aspects of COVID. I know we Democrats in the House have provided for money, but we have that not in the COVID bill, but in the appropriations bills that won't become effective till October 1st at the earliest. And we clearly need to respond internationally sooner. I met with Aung San Suu Kyi more than once. She had become such a hero to all of us who are concerned about human rights. And to have her play this role, presiding over and apologizing for this genocidal regime, is just disheartening to everyone who has put their time and effort into human rights. Last year, I had a chance to preside over this subcommittee. We had three hearings dealing with the Rohingya in part. We had our hearing on Southeast Asian human rights, where we focused on Burma, Myanmar, South Asia, where we focused on the effect on Bangladesh, and finally the budget hearings. I want to commend Chairman Barra, though, for having a hearing entirely focused on the Rohingya. It's that it is clearly deserving of a hearing all by itself. The Rohingya need to go home. They need to go home safely. They need to go home with full citizenship rights. Several years ago, and as recently as last year, I pointed out that perhaps the international border would need to be changed. If the government of Burma, Myanmar won't protect the people of North Rakhine State, then maybe that state should be part of another nation or independent. Now, I don't think a change of international borders is anything close to an optimal solution. But I will point out to those in the Burmese government that America has favored and facilitated only once this century a change in international borders, and that was the creation of South Sudan. And we did it because of our abiding efforts to prevent genocide. And there was genocide there in South Sudan, and there's clearly been a genocide attempted to be perpetrated against the Rohingya people. We could be looking at a temporary safe zone inside the Rakhine State with international UN peacekeeping troops, but that would be just a first and inadequate step because we need the people of Rakhine State to be full citizens of Burma. A number of people have pointed out the importance of the Burma Act. We've passed it through the committee. We need to pass it to the floor. And I see on my screen Ms. Wagner, who joined with me when I introduced the Safe Return of the Rohingya to Burma Act. And this would go further in revoking Burma's GSP preferences. I know Mr. Yoho focused on the economic. We may not easily control what China does economically, but we certainly have control over what we do. And we've given Burma extraordinary GSP preferences that we don't provide to a host of other countries. And clearly that should not go on. And that would have an immediate economic effect on Burma. We wouldn't have to wait for a determination. It wouldn't be just aimed at one or two individuals, but would affect the regime. There is a, Mr. Yoho and others have brought up China. China has signed 33 major economic agreements with this regime. It oppresses its own Uyghur Muslims. It has offered cash to Rohingya to return to their homes, but without any guarantees of safety, they're not going to do it. And now China has its eyes on the Rohingya, on the Rakhine State as a place for a port that would support the Chinese economy. I would hope that for the record, our witnesses would tell us what we can do to illustrate to the entire Muslim world what China is doing, not only to the Uyghurs, but in support of the Burmese regime. And I'll point out that in contrast, the United States gets criticized as somehow being anti-Muslim. Not only do we stand up for the Rohingya and the Uyghurs, but we took military action against Serbia to support the Kosovars and the Bosnian Muslims. how much additional assistance do we need to provide to support the Rohingya, in addition to the, I'm told it's as high as $660 million we've provided so far? Do we have a witness that can, perhaps Mr. Schwartz?
Yeah, let me address 3 points that that you alluded to,
I have limited time, so perhaps you could address the aid question.
Well, yeah, I would say that the United States has been a very generous contributor to the humanitarian response in Bangladesh. But the global appeal at last report was funded at far less than 50%. So much more can and should be done. But I do need to comment on your reference to a safe zone. As someone who wrote an op-ed in the Washington Post urging that any return be accompanied by a UN monitoring team. So I think the phrase safe zone makes me nervous because safe zones is a general matter, you know, whether it's been in Bosnia or other parts of the world are not safe. And so I think that we have to be certain that conditions are right for safe and voluntary return with monitoring. But I get very nervous when I hear the phrase safe zone. So I would be
maybe a different term is called for, but international monitoring, I think, would be helpful. I'll also ask our witnesses to comment on the record about the International Criminal Court, which held that Myanmar must take steps to prevent further genocidal acts. And I want to commend the Gambia for bringing the case, and focusing on human rights so far from the Gambia. And I want to pick up on Ms. YY News' comment about the elections. I'll point out that some 850,000 Afghan refugees in 2004 were able to participate in the Afghan elections. You've called for Rohingya to be able to participate in the Myanmar elections. I know Myanmar authorities have detailed records and household lists. It seems that as a practical matter, the Rohingya could participate. Should the world, if the Myanmar government refuses to allow them to participate, should the world regard this as a legitimate election?
Knowing that we've gone over time, if the witnesses perhaps could answer some of those questions and submit them for the record, that would be great. Thank you. With that, let me recognize.
I would ask that the witness be given just one or two sentences.
Okay, I will grant that to Mr. Sherman if the witnesses want to keep.
Yeah, just the one witness. Ms. Newman.
Thank you, Congressman Sherman. I think you're very really right. Populations want to be able to have our right to political rights to vote and to participate in the elections. And there are precedences that in the past that could happen. And as you rightly said, Burmese government has our family registration lists and cards, as well as the voting list from the 2010 elections. So it's not difficult if there is a will and a plan to arrange this, this to happen. And it doesn't take much long. And secondly, regarding...
Thank you. I've gone
away. Yeah, let me recognize the gentlelady from Missouri, Ms. Wagner, for 5 minutes.
I want to thank you, Mr. Chairman, for hosting this hearing on an issue that's extremely bipartisan. And I thank our witnesses for their time and for their expertise today. My heart breaks for the Rohingya, who have suffered unimaginable atrocities at the hands of the genocidal Burmese regime and now face an incipient coronavirus outbreak in Cox's Bazar, Bangladesh. Along with Congressman Levin, who I know is joining us today, I co-led an amendment to the State and Foreign Operations Appropriations Act that ensures that U.S. funds will not be used to support the forced relocation of Rohingya refugees to Bazanshar, an uninhabitable strip of silt off the coast of Bangladesh. So Bangladesh has already begun to detain refugees on Bazancour and has refused to allow UN officials access to the island. Mr. Schwartz, how can we ensure Rohingya on Bazancour are receiving the humanitarian aid that they need?
Well, I think we have to, members of Congress and the administration has to continue to press the authorities in Bangladesh, number one, not to be moving refugees to Bazancour until there is an independent assessment of safety and voluntariness. And I would urge that members of Congress and the administration press the government of Bangladesh on the issue of access now. And I think the 300 or so who are on the island, if they don't, if access isn't permitted, then then we need to press for those people to be returned to camps. The issue is clear and straightforward. If the government of Bangladesh believes, as it says, that this is a habitable island and conditions are good for the refugees, then there should be no problem with an assessment, an independent assessment of the safety of the island prior to moving people to it. It's really that simple.
Thank you, Mr. Schwartz. In November 2019, as Congressman Sherman has referenced, Gambia filed a genocide case against Burma at the International Court of Justice, or ICJ, beginning a very long overdue effort to designate the atrocities committed against the Rohingya as genocide and punish the perpetrators for their crimes. While consideration of the case continues, the ICJ has ordered Burma to take actions to prevent further acts of genocide. Ms. Enos, how well is Burma complying with the ICJ's order to actively prevent additional acts of genocide? And how can the international community pressure Burma into compliance?
Thank you for that question. I think that to the best of my knowledge, they are not taking steps to comply. And critically, I think what we need to be watching for is the fact that the Burmese military has been engaging in activities that seem very similar, in fact, to what happened in August 2017. They've even used the language of clearing operations in some contexts. We know that there have been civilians that have been targeted and tortured in Rakhine State. And so we know that the Burmese military is continuing to be emboldened to act in these ways. So any sort of efforts by the civilian government or otherwise to say that they are complying are simply not true for many Rohingya as well as other religious minorities inside of Burma. And I think this is why we need the U.S. government to call a spade a spade and finally say that this is genocide, this is crimes against humanity. Echo what the United Nations has said, echo what the ICJ has found, echo what even the U.S. Holocaust Memorial Museum, I think the U.S. Commission on International Religious Freedom, so many bodies, including civil society, have been saying that this is genocide and crimes against humanity, but thus far the U.S. refuses to say that it is what it is. And the genocide, fear, it is crimes against humanity.
The fear and uncertainty also caused by the pandemic are exacerbating tensions between Rohingya refugees and local communities in Bangladesh. Ms. New, briefly, how can aid groups and partner countries protect Rohingya refugees who are being scapegoated for the coronavirus outbreak? Ms. New?
Thank you for your questions. Yes, I think aid groups and the partner countries, first thing we need is that the consultations and talking to the people and on their needs and their assessing their situation thoroughly, not just ticking box in what they need and what their situations are. What we have been seeing throughout the last 7 years is that the donor organizations, countries, and the partner implementing organizations are not necessarily discussing with the community, with the refugees, on their needs and on their situations. For example, the women that I have talked to, women that I've been working on, has from the rape in Burma, she has endured physically terribly. Now she cannot walk because of her backbone has broken. So for her, during the COVID-19, she cannot even go out, and during the lockdown, there is no for her, it's impossible that she can get any assistance during this kind of this lockdown and COVID-19. So that is why I think the most important thing is that to consult and to listen to the community as much as possible. That's the first thing. Secondly, about the your questions around the ICJs and international criminal accountability. One of a few things that U.S. and your committee can concretely do is that the first one, asking Facebook and Twitter to provide their evidences to the Gambia, to the ICJ. That's the most important thing. And secondly, supporting Gambia processes and International Court of Justice and International Criminal Court processes at the UN General Assembly and at the Security Council.
Thank you.
Thank you. I am way over time, Mr. Chairman. My supreme apologies. But thank you to all our witnesses. They have so much to offer, and these are these virtual things are a little clunky to do. So I yield back, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Ms. Wagner. And let me now recognize the gentlelady from Nevada, Ms. Titus.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. The testimony has been quite interesting. I was reading recently from the last issue of Foreign Affairs an article called The Myanmar Mirage: Why the West Got Burma Wrong. It's primarily a review of a book called The Hidden History of Burma. And it makes the argument that a lot of the vacillating international perceptions of Myanmar, from pariah state to positive, possible democratic success story, now back to pariah state again, have more to do with our hopes than with Burmese realities. It goes on to quote a journalist, Peter Popham, who's argued that Aung San Suu's mystique has really originated from her absence, and she has been a blank screen on which we have painted what we hoped would be her characteristics, her demeanor, her approach to politics, not necessarily what her background is. So I'm wondering if you all would address maybe the question of how we got it wrong and how we might reassess what our policy is going forward based on this notion of Myanmar's history, its culture, its structural problems, its racial tensions, that maybe we need to reassess our own policy.
I'll take that first, if you don't mind. I think that one of the challenges with U.S. policy toward Burma has been its inconsistency, as you pointed out. And one of the things that happened toward the tail end of the Obama administration was what I would argue is a premature lifting of sanctions on the Burmese military at a very critical moment. We saw this potential opening toward democracy that Burma was taking, and I think we did get our hopes up. And so we lifted those sanctions. I think slowly but surely, we've started to see the re-implementation of many of those sanctions, including the notable sanctions against Senior General Min Aung Hlaing and others, as well as against the 33rd and 99th Light Infantry Divisions, all of which happened under the Trump administration. And these are welcome changes, but they don't demonstrate a reset of U.S. policy toward Burma, which is something I've advocated for in several of my papers at Heritage. And I think one way to reset and recast U.S. policy toward Burma would be to go ahead and issue an atrocity determination, whether that's genocide or crimes against humanity, and then to bring the sanctions policy in line with that in such a way that it actually targets the military-owned enterprises that are truly enabling the Burmese military to step on any possibilities for democratic reform that we might see under a civilian government.
Thank you. Somebody else might respond to how do we do this without pushing Burma further and further into the arms of China? That's right now, that relationship is fairly tenuous, but they're only too willing to be an economic supporter and a friendly ally.
Let me comment on that. And I share the view that I think there was what I might call a little bit of irrational exuberance about where this political situation was going, and excitement about Aung San Suu Kyi. I think there's much to what you said about, we sort of create our own images and perceptions about people, treating them as foreign leaders, treating them as blank slates. But I don't think that alter, and secondly, I would say the situation is very complex. Your comment about China demonstrates that. And so, but it doesn't change the fact that we should be promoting basic decency and basic respect for human rights on the part of the authorities in Burma. And what that means is a concentrated, coherent strategy that recognizes complexity. You're not going to get the government of China to support a genocide declaration, right, or support a Security Council condemnation. But sticks, strong measures by like-minded governments have got to be part of an overall strategy, including a genocide determination, while at the same time, U.S. diplomats should be engaging Chinese leaders, Indian leaders, who are more reluctant to take strong measures and see what we can achieve with respect to movement on these issues. 2 minutes of in a hearing is not a forum in which to describe what a strategy is. But a strategy requires American leadership, which is not there right now in terms of a coherent, concerted diplomatic effort that recognizes that in some cases you've got to really implement and utilize sticks, and in other cases, with governments that are far more reluctant to take strong measures, you've got to engage diplomacy. And I think both are critical to an effective strategy if the goal is to improve the well-being and the lives of the Rohingya people in particular and ethnic minorities throughout Burma.
Thank you.
If I may,
Go ahead briefly, Ms. Nguyen.
Thank you. I echo both Olivia and Mr. Eric. I would like to just want to say that we should go back to the U.S. Policy and strategy before, so-called democratic transition. We need to go back to the strategy during the military dictatorship. Since we can say this is the failed democracy, the civilian government is not upholding any democratic principle and not protecting the minorities and, letting the genocide happen, continuing the genocide at its own country. So that's my main suggestions or asks. And also, the situations in Rakhine State, the suffering of Rohingya is not now that just the issue of Myanmar. It's become international issue. Our people have been suffering in Bangladesh, Malaysia, India, and elsewhere. So it cannot be addressed unilaterally, and it has to come up with a very constructive strategy. And going back to your leadership, as multinational responses, that I think that's the critical thing. And also talking about the sanctions and economy, and I think it is important that not only sanctioning individuals but also targeting the institutions itself. And I would like to request the committee to submit my written submissions on our partners on the businesses and military's businesses in and misconducts in Myanmar.
Thank you. Unfortunately, we have an administration right now that doesn't believe in much cooperation with other international partners. Just briefly, I was in Myanmar with part of the House Democracy Partnership, and that group works with new democracies, and we were optimistic. And we work with USAID and NGOs in the countries who make such a difference with that soft power or diplomacy. And I, at some point in the future, I'd like to hear y'all tell me more about your access currently under this administration and also under the conditions of the COVID virus. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thanks, Ms. Titus. Now, let me go ahead and recognize the gentlelady from Pennsylvania, Ms. Houlihan.
Thank you, Chairman. And thank you to the panelists for coming. I wanted to follow up on a couple of things that my colleagues have said. First off, Mr. Sherman, to reemphasize, and I believe Mr. Barra as well, the importance of federally funding our foreign affairs in this COVID package that we're working on. I think it's essential. I think we're seeing on the Senate side at least an appetite for that, and I would like to see on the House side an appetite as well to include it in our next package. So I just want to associate myself with those remarks. I also wanted to follow up on something that Ms. Wagner talked about, which has to do with what we're seeing that looks a lot like 2017 played over again, and would like to understand from possibly Ms. Enos or Ms. New what you're seeing now, what you saw in 2017, what can Congress do in terms of lesson learned from 2017 until now? You touched a little bit on some of those, ticked them off, but is there anything further that you can add to that? And can we ask you all for the record to submit some ideas of what lessons we can learn from the 2017 for now? So maybe Ms. Enos?
Okay, great. Thank you for your question. Yes, I do think that we're starting to see an uptick in violence. And honestly, there has been consistent targeting from the Burmese military of various minority communities, including in Shan and Kachin State, but also in Rakhine State. And I'm happy to submit, you know, additional materials that go into great detail about that. But beyond lessons from, you know, 2017, I think that there are also lessons from the election previously, because we are going to have an election in Burma here in, you know, November potentially. And again, we are seeing Rohingya being excluded as being able to vote. And we cannot consider it a free and fair election when Rohingya and other minority groups are not permitted to vote. And so I think that this election actually presents an opportunity for U.S. advocacy and U.S. diplomacy to really up the ante and put pressure on Burma and both the civilian and the military government to respect the fundamental rights of all of its citizens, minority or not, to be able to participate in the democratic process. So I think that's maybe something also to
keep in mind. That would be terrific, too. That would be terrific, too. Ms. New, do you have anything to add that we could maybe put into the congressional record in this area?
Yes, thank you very much. I would like to add some more points. And one of the main things that the lesson learned during the 2017 is that I think the impunity of the perpetrators. So the violence against the Rohingya started in 2012, and it goes on in 2013, 14, 15, and 2016. While the attack happened, the U.S. government lifted the sanctions from Myanmar, and that is the worst thing that could happen. And that led the larger, you know, five times larger atrocities in 2017. And I think that's the lesson learned from me. We've been advocating and telling the U.S. government and many others, policymakers around the world, that we need to end impunity of the perpetrators. And there were little actions or little interests from the U.S. government. And that is the main thing that led to the 2017. Now, we cannot wait any longer, because the more we wait, the longer injustice will be, and the suffering of the communities will prolong, not just the Rohingya, but also the Rakhine and other ethnic communities. From January to May, there are one of our partners' record, 410 attacks against the civilians happened More than 300 civilians have been killed, and the continuous abuses and violations by the security forces, such as extrajudicial killing, arbitrary arrests, has been ongoing, and Rohingya are stuck in the middle of, caught up in the middle of the war zone without protections from any parties in Rakhine State. So we need to end impunity.
Thank you. That was very helpful. And with whatever's left of my time, I am really dubious about the report of only 62 cases of COVID. Here in my community, we had a nursing home that had 62 deaths of COVID. And so it's really hard to imagine that that is true. Can anybody give me any insight into whether or not this is just an issue of testing or really is there some sort of something else going on there? And also, are you seeing an increase or spike in cases of other kinds of diseases? And finally, is the WHO still even at all able to be helpful? And what can you comment, if anything, about us withdrawing from the WHO during all of this situation?
I'll just briefly address the issue of 62 cases. I think that this is in part an issue of testing and access to testing. It's also a lack of access to medical care. As I understand it, there have been limits placed on the number of humanitarian agencies that can work during the COVID-19 era, in part to help stop the spread, but also that means that a lack of access to medical care in general is pervading. And I think we're seeing this especially affecting women and girls, especially those who are pregnant. There have been reports of women not being able to get access to maternal health care for labor, birth, and delivery that are extraordinarily concerning. Some of this has to do with some of the more male-dominated structures within the camps that are limiting and restricting their access. But some of it also has to do with misinformation that is running rampant in the camps, that women are in fact the cause of COVID-19 in these camps. And I think that the spread of misinformation is easily preventable simply by the Bangladeshi government lifting those restrictions on access to internet and telecommunications that they put in place. This is a very preventable problem and something that I think strong diplomacy coming from U.S. State Department and otherwise would be able to help to address. So I think that, in part answers your question.
Thank you. I think my time is well past expired. I don't see a clock, but I apologize and I yield back.
No worries. Thank you, Ms. Houlihan. Let me recognize the gentleman from Michigan, Mr. Levin, for 5 minutes.
Thank you so much, Mr. Chairman, and I want to thank you and the ranking member for holding this important hearing. I had the privilege of traveling to Bangladesh last year and to spend 2 full days in and around the Rohingya refugee camps and the host communities in rural areas around Cox's Bazar. And while I by no means at all want to downplay the horror of the situation, I want to take a moment to recognize the common humanity we share with the Rohingya people. When we sat down and talked with mothers, they said they wish they could offer us a meal as their guests. When we asked parents what brought them joy, they said seeing their children happy. Our lives are very different, but at the end of the day, we're talking about families like yours and mine who want to have a warm and happy home where their kids are safe and can thrive. And it breaks my heart that for those families I met, that home and that peace are still far, far out of reach. So I want to talk first about what it would mean for Rohingya refugees to return to Burma. I spoke with one man who had fled Burma 3 times in his life. This was his 3rd time as a refugee. But he still considered it home and wanted to go back and spoke about the smell of his farm animals and the water and so on. And in fact, most of the people we spoke with hoped to go back to Burma. So let's talk about this. Mr. Schwartz, there have actually been multiple spikes in violence against Rohingya in Burma over decades, going back to the 1970s. And so multiple cases of Rohingya people fleeing to Bangladesh. In those past cases, what allowed for Rohingya people to return to Burma?
Well, what the situation for Rohingya in Rakhine State in recent memory has never been acceptable. They've been subjected to the denial of their right to political participation and other abuses But the truth of the matter is what we saw in 2017 was unprecedented in terms of the concentrated nature of the mass expulsion, the numbers of people who moved in such an extraordinarily short period of time, hundreds of thousands. When I was there in mid September, which was just about a month into the crisis, I think the numbers were several hundred thousand already. The fact that an estimated 6,000 to 7,000 people were killed in the context of that expulsion. I mean, the virulence of the government's actions and the military's actions in that case was of a different order of magnitude.
No question. But what I'm trying to ask is there a history of truly voluntary repatriations and folks being able to go back in peace and actually reclaim, you know, their possessions, their land, and so forth?
There has been movement back and forth, some movement back and forth in the context of prior, you know, violations of the rights of the Rohingya. But I think you're testing the limits of my historical knowledge. I think.
Okay. Well, so I guess what I want to say is that I am very concerned that any repatriations would have to be, you know, truly voluntary. And I think they're going to require a kind of multilateral foreign policy that the ranking member expressed eloquently, but that I have to say to my brother, this administration has no interest in carrying out and working with our allies as a team, you know, to deal with this, with a situation like the, you know, the Rohingya, this horrible genocide that we've watched and they've had to deal with. Let me just ask quickly about more about Basan Char, which I did work on a bill with Congresswoman Wagner that she mentioned. I'm very worried about more people being forced onto this island. It's dangerous. I don't see it being a truly safe place. You spoke to this, that they should allow independent evaluations, but what more can the U.S. do to stop forced relocations to Basan Char? What specific steps do you, Mr. Schwartz, or others think we could take, again, if it's multilateral, fine, but to prevent this from happening?
This is a perfect example of what I would call the carrot and stick approach. I mean, I think on the one hand, our diplomats need to be talking very sharply to the government of Bangladesh about the critical importance of an independent assessment before people are moved to the island. At the same time, we are thanking the government of Bangladesh for providing refuge to the Rohingya, and at the same time that we are rallying support for additional financial assistance for the humanitarian effort in the camps. And in addition, I think part of that is movement on a genocide determination, because it signals to the government of Bangladesh that we recognize that the problem is in Burma, and that it's an expression of solidarity with a country that has expressed deep concerns about the burden, about the responsibilities that they have taken on with respect to the Rohingya. So I would say it's got to be, as I said before, you know, it's a complex issue, and I think we have to talk tough with the government of Bangladesh on what they should and shouldn't be doing with respect to Basan Char, while at the same time, I think we need to be continuing to support their efforts to play host, you know, to this beleaguered population.
Thank you. And Mr. Chairman, I think my time's well expired. So I appreciate your leadership on this issue and that of the ranking member, and I yield back.
Thank you, Mr. Levin. Let me now recognize the gentleman from Tennessee, Dr. Green, and welcome to the subcommittee in the hearing.
Thanks, Chairman. I really appreciate it. I'm honored to be here, and thanks, too, to the ranking member. I also should probably thank Chairman McCall and Chairman Engel for just honoring me and letting me be on the House Foreign Affairs Committee. International relations have been a passion of mine since I took the oath to defend the country in 1982 on the plane at West Point, long time ago, and been enhanced, of course, my trips all over the world and my two deployments to Iraq and Afghanistan. I believe that foreign policy and foreign affairs right now probably the most challenging ever in the United States' history, far more complex than ever before. Multiple domains, interactions where we connect and interact with our friends and foes and allies, and layer over that climate and COVID and all these other things just makes it harder. And Myanmar is an excellent example of that, where we face an Asian nation undergoing this humanitarian human rights crisis. But as in the past, when Americans fight for other nations and people's human rights, we bring security to our own world and thus ourselves. We have to stand with these people who are, I mean, this is an atrocity. It is, as has been called already in the committee meeting, genocide in some ways. However, we also have to consider, and I think it was Representative Titus who mentioned this, China continues to grow its malign influence throughout the world. Relationships in that region are clearly have to be considered and how it empowers their actions. As a new member today, I just have one question, and I won't take nearly all of my time. And let me also say, I did have to step out, so I may be asking a question that's already been asked. If that's the case, then just move on, and I'll get it from the transcript. But Ms. Enos, I believe there was an international court ruling earlier this year, and I wondered if that court ruling has made any difference, and if so, you know, in what way, and what else can the courts do here to help us?
Thank you for that question. We did briefly touch on it, but I'm happy to address it in more depth. So I think the case that the Gambia brought at the International Court of Justice against Burma was a significant one. And not only did it raise the profile of the issue of genocide and the atrocities that Rohingya faced, but I think it also made it so that there was a greater desire for international pressure. And it put Aung San Suu Kyi, in fact, on the spot, where she was actually defending the Burmese military and the atrocities that they committed. And so I think that reveals that there's a much deeper need for reform inside of Burma, for political reform in general, that recognizes the fundamental rights of all individuals, minorities, or otherwise inside of Burma. And so I think this was a very important case indeed. But I think that there is even a further need for the U.S. government to just go ahead and issue that atrocity determination, because I think that we've seen other international bodies, in fact, pursuing forms of accountability. But the U.S. decision not to call it genocide, not to call it crimes against humanity, I think has really hampered international aid efforts. And I think if you were to have such a determination, you have the potential to really galvanize much needed aid and assistance during a time when needs are ever increasing with COVID-19. And I would just add very briefly that any sort of atrocity determination that's issued does not require any sort of new case before the ICJ or the ICC. It actually doesn't have any sort of legal requirements to pursue international justice. But I do think that the administration would be wise to pursue alternative legal and judicial mechanisms for holding the Burmese military accountable, in addition to targeting and levying the much needed sanctions, and continuing that sanctions pressure against the Burmese military, especially against Burmese military-owned enterprises.
Thank you. Did I pronounce your name correctly, by the way?
That's right. Olivia Enos. Yes.
Okay. I'm sorry if I got it wrong. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I yield.
Thank you, Dr. Green. And thank you to the members for their questions and to the witnesses for their responses. With member questions not concluded, I'm going to recognize myself for some closing comments and also recognize the ranking member for closing comments, and then give our witnesses an opportunity, maybe 30 seconds or a minute, if there are any closing remarks that they would like to make. What we said today really highlights the urgency and the importance of Congress, along with the administration, taking actions. And yes, as a number of members highlighted, we had hopes of the burgeoning democracy. We had hopes with Aung San Suu Kyi that Burma might move in the right direction. But as we realized, you know, with the actions taken in 2017 and the continued actions of the military government and the lack of response from Aung San Suu Kyi, we have to now step up and reset the clock and, you know, go back to, you know, some of the sanctions and efforts that were placed. And as multiple members, as well as the witnesses, also suggested that this is something that would be much stronger if we do it in a multilateral way, using the institutions and organizations that are available to us, including the United Nations. And, you know, the urgency is now, because each day we wait, you know, is continued suffering. Each day we wait allows the government to continue to get away with these atrocities and, you know, perpetrate additional atrocities. And, you know, it's not just limited to what we're seeing with the Rohingya. We're seeing these atrocities throughout the world. And, you know, the urgency of now in the midst of this pandemic, knowing that we have to deal with the pandemic, the real worry of the secondary and tertiary impacts of you know, massive starvation, food insecurity, the other infectious diseases that will be emerging because of the focus on the pandemic. All of these are in urgent need of a global response, with wealthier nations coming together to help those that are less fortunate. An important first step, and again, a number of the witnesses touched on it, is as we do negotiate this next COVID-19 bill, we do need to have global health funding in there, and, you know, and we need to keep that in there, because there is an urgency of now. I appreciate the generosity of the appropriations bill and the resources that were in that appropriations bill. But as Congressman Sherman pointed out, you know, that's not coming until October, and perhaps even later than that. So, with that, you know, let me recognize the ranking member, Mr. Yoho, for any closing comments.
Ami, I really appreciate what you're doing as chairmanship again. I think you're doing a just a fantastic job. I appreciate everybody participating, especially our witnesses. But I've got to make a few comments here, because I saw this administration being attacked and not doing enough, dropping the ball on this. But we've had two witnesses talk about, you know, under President Obama, the sanctions got released. Hillary Clinton, as Secretary of State, was bragging about the democracy she helped form in Burma when it was a shell game, we find out now. And these atrocities were going on way before this, and they continued all the way through this. But the work that happened in the State Department allowed for the sanctions to be released. And so these attacks are tawdry. I mean, they're just cheap shots that aren't going to solve any problems. And I really don't appreciate this. If we don't come together like we did with the Build Act that created the DFC in this administration, I would encourage my colleagues that don't think this administration is doing enough. Look at what the USAID has done. Look at what the DFC has done. You know, getting ventilators and equipment out around the world. There's been over $6 billion in DFC alone to fight the pandemic. $3 billion was, I think, directly from the US taxpayers, and they brought in $3 billion from outside organizations. So if you want to focus on politics, that's great. This is not the place to do it. We need to come together with policies that we can pass in a bipartisan manner that we can get and work through the Senate so that we can get these policies enacted, so that we can bring this genocide, which is ultimately what this hearing's about, to an end. And we can only do that if we're working bipartisanly together. Mr. Chairman, thank you for what you do. And again, I appreciate our witnesses.
Since I see Congressman Sherman, I'm still on. Brad, would you like to make any closing comments or?
I just want to thank you for having this hearing and focusing our attention on the Rohingya, and for doing an outstanding job with the subcommittee.
Great. Thank you, Mr. Sherman. I'll give the witnesses an opportunity to make a brief closing comments, and let's go in reverse order, and we'll start with Ms. Neville.
Thank you, Chairman, and thank you, Ranking Member. I just want to close by saying a couple of things. One, there is this immediate issue now with needing to address the COVID-19 pandemic, and I really appreciate everyone who has highlighted those needs. And I'd be happy to follow up in some questions for the record if we can talk a little bit more about what we've been seeing on the ground. But a couple of things, following on from Mr. Schwartz, I would say there's an absolute need to appreciate everything that the government of Bangladesh has done in welcoming, you know, what amounts to nearly 1 million refugees into their country. At the same time, there, you know, certainly continue to be challenges. There's always going to be challenges in any humanitarian context. But a few things like sort of restrictions on mobile access and internet access, which Chairman Barra, I know you've weighed in on as well. Those things affect two different areas. One is just access to information and being able to combat misinformation about the virus, which is incredibly, incredibly important given, you know, the need for limited access in the camps to avoid further spreading the virus to the Rohingya refugees. And then second, Chairman Barra, you also highlighted this as well, is just the need, the ways in which mobile data access would actually help humanitarian programming that needs to be remote and distant at this point in time. So not having the ability to carry things out via mobile and internet really does create a lot of challenges for us as we're responding. And I just want to really make sure we connect the situation in Bangladesh for these refugees, because as we've been highlighting, this is not an ideal long-term solution by any stretch of the imagination. So truly the only real solution is for the Rohingya to be able to return home, which is what they want to do, but the conditions have to exist for them to be able to do so. So these two countries and the situations on the ground in these two countries are intimately tied together. I mean, we really do need to be putting emphasis on what's happening on the ground. And there are opportunities, especially in Central Rakhine, where you know, we do a lot of programming. There are so many opportunities to make progress towards security, towards, you know, improving rights and other conditions for the Rohingya. And I think that's a place where we also need to have a great deal of emphasis. So thank you. I really appreciate you having this hearing and happy to answer further questions.
Great. Thanks, Ms. Knapp. Let me recognize Ms. Enos.
Thank you. I'll be brief. I think there's no greater moment than the present to make a decision to issue an atrocity determination. This is something that Secretary Pompeo can do at any moment in time, and Congress can certainly call on him and press on the administration to go ahead and issue that determination. I think at a moment in time when the needs are being amplified and deepened even more during COVID-19, this is a great time for Congress to up the ante and put pressure in order to have this happen. It would also be a great time for the administration to just go ahead and issue that determination, whether that's genocide or crimes against humanity or both. So that's my, you know, sort of spiel, but thank you so much for the opportunity to be able to come here to speak to you all.
Thank you, Ms. Enos. Ms. New.
Thank you, Chair. First of all, I would like to say my gratitude and thanks for the for your consistent bipartisan support on Burma and you know, really supporting Burma human rights and democracy. And now I'd like to remind everyone and ourselves that we are now here dealing with the genocide, crimes against humanity, and war crimes, international crimes. We need your leadership more than ever. When the first crisis happened in 1978, the refugee crisis, the late Senator Edward Kennedy took leadership and facilitated the return of the refugees. But then the international community and the world has failed to address root causes. Now we are seeing recurrence and repeating the crimes again and again up to here, where we are now, you know, dealing with the genocide. So therefore, I would like to say we need your leadership more than ever at this point, and you can do a couple of things. First, We need to end impunity. You can take leadership, ask the U.S. government to take leadership at the Security Council to call for the meeting on Burma and to issue the resolutions on ending impunity, supporting international court of justice or international criminal court, or creating even ad hoc international tribunals to hold the perpetrators accountable and bring in justice for the Rohingya. And secondly, the United States really need a coherent and consistent and constructive strategy to address the overall bigger picture of Burma democracy and human rights and protecting the Rohingya's right. And assessing the funding and donations, everything, the effectiveness of those are essential and key. And I would like to say thank you again for giving me this opportunity and floor to address you today.
Thank you, Mr. Schwartz.
Members of the subcommittee for holding this important meeting and for your commitment on this issue. I would just ask that members of Congress and all of us don't make assumptions about so-called lost causes. When I joined the staff of the subcommittee that you now chair, the Subcommittee on Asian and Pacific Affairs, in April of 1989, the idea that a Latvia, an Estonia, a Lithuania would ever have its freedom was unimaginable. When Indonesian troops invaded East Timor in the mid-70s, the idea that Timor would ever be an independent country was also almost unimaginable. And what sustained that flicker of hope and the potential for the human rights and freedom was a willingness of some governments of the world and non-governmental organizations and activists to sustain a degree of illegitimacy for what governments that violated human rights had done. And I just ask that when you think about the Rohingya as a potential lost cause, you think about those historical examples. And for us at this point, I think a singular effort, have the Department of State, the Secretary of State, recognize these crimes as genocide would help to sustain that degree of illegitimacy for what that government has done. And, we have been Refugees International and 80 non-governmental organizations, more than 80 non-governmental organizations, legal experts, human rights experts, thousands of individuals have been engaged in a campaign to encourage the Secretary of State to make that determination, to make that designation. And I would just ask that members of Congress join us in that effort, because I think it is very important and could indeed make a difference.
Thank you, Mr. Schwartz. And I want to thank all of our witnesses for all the work that you do and the advocacy that you do on behalf of people around the world that may not have that ability to advocate for the humanity. I also want to thank the members who participated in this hearing, and with that, as well as thank the ranking member for his partnership here. With that, this hearing is adjourned.